decide to adopt the euro, those adopting that, they relinquish the monetary sovereignty, and the ECB has taken on the responsibility for the monetary policy in the euro. But when we say the ECB, in fact, there is a lot of confusion. Many people wonder what is the role now of the national central banks. More than often receive the question when I was a central bank governor. Many people think they could simply have disappeared. Others fear that the ECB being settled in Frankfurt would ignore the reality, the needs of the different territories, regions, countries to which its monetary policy applies. Of course, the reality is quite different. Under the EU treaty, it is really the ESCB that is entrusted with carrying out central banking functions for the euro. The ESCB for the European System of Central Banks. So the ESCB has no legal personality of its own. The real actors are the ECB and the NCBs of the euro countries. They jointly exercise the core functions of the ESCB. And they do it under the name Eurosystem. So I will discuss with the Eurosystem, how it works, what is the operational setup, the link with national tasks, and the last issue is banking supervision, which is the new thing. Now, why did we decide in 1998 to adopt the term Eurosystem, which was not at the time of the treaty, now is enshrined in the treaty? Well, there are basically two reasons. One is that we wanted to underline the organic link between the ECB and the NCBs, show that we act jointly as a system, federal system, by the way, I will come back to that in a moment, in which basically the decision-making is centralized and the tasks are performed jointly, mostly by the NCBs in a decentralized way. A second reason is that in the wording of the treaty, the ESCB includes the ECB and all 28 NCBs, all countries, including those of non-participating countries, and of course the latter are not involved in carrying out the functions. And therefore we thought the distinct wording was appropriate to avoid confusion. But more fundamentally, why? What were the reasons why a system was established to carry out central bank functions for the euro and not a single central bank? There were three arguments put forward traditionally. One is that the establishment of a simple institution, possibly concentrating central bank business in one single place, would not have been acceptable in political terms. We should always remember that the Delors Committee, that was preparing on the EMU, was made out mostly of central bank governors. This was, by the way, the concept of Jacques Delors himself. He wanted that to make sure that it would work. The second reason is that we wanted the Eurosystem to be built on the experience of national central banks to preserve their institutional setup, their infrastructure, their operational capabilities, their expertise. And that was all the more important, as we saw it, that NCBs continue to perform non-Eurosystem related tasks. And finally, the URA is a large geographic area, and therefore the decentralized framework allows credit institutions to have a better access point, it's closer to them, to have their relationships with the Eurosystems using each domesticated system, using each national language, and that's a big asset. Beyond those analytical reasons, as we could say, I personally believe that this type of organization is in fact truly federal. I think we often make a mistake in Europe, perhaps not in Ireland, but certainly in France. I think federal means centralized. It's not at all the way it works. At least if we look at the Federal Reserve System, which is our natural comparator, we find something very similar. The Board of Governors in Washington is performing functions that are very close to those of the ECB. And the 12 Federal Reserve banks conduct activities and operations in each of the districts, the 12 districts. And that's close to what the ECBs do. There is a major difference that lies in the fact that due to the concentration of financial markets and major banks in New York, the Federal Reserve Bank of New York takes a prominent role over its sister FRBs as far as market operations are concerned. But the philosophy behind the system, centralized decision making, decentralized implementation, is largely the same. And it's the same for all the functions of market operations. One important feature of this framework is that all members of the Eurosystem are truly and only part of the system as long as they perform Eurosystem related functions. Of course, each ECB has its own legal personality within the national law, but they are all integral parts of the Eurosystem. That's in the treaty, it's in the statutes, annexed to the treaty and the statutes of the ECB. When they carry out tasks that has been delegated by the Governing Council of ECB, in line with the principle of decentralization, following guidelines established by the Council, following instructions, and as shareholders of the ECB, the ECBs, of course, endow the ECB with capital and foreign reserve assets, they participate in financial results. So the links are extremely strong. And one could add that the national legislation has been brought in line in each case with European law, protecting independence and making sure that the ECBs have all the qualities to be full members of the Eurosystem. But how does this system work in practice? And what are the respective tasks of the ECB and the ECBs? Before answering the question, let me recall quickly what are the basic tasks of the Eurosystem as described in the Treaty and the Statutes. They are the following. One, to define and implement the monetary policy of the Euro-area. Second, to conduct foreign exchange operations. Third, to hold and manage the official foreign reserves of the Euro-area member states. Then, to promote the smooth operation of payment systems. Then, to issue Euro banknotes as the only such notes to have the status of legal tender of the Euro-area. And finally, the treaty says to collect the statistical information necessary for the tasks of the Eurosystem. So it's more than simply monetary policy, it's a lot of things around. and how do they do that? Well, for the performance of this task, the statute of the ECB assigns to the ECB and the ECBs a wide range of functional and operational competencies, open markets, operations, credit operations, minimum reserves, regulation of clearing and payment systems, etc. A number of things, a number of tools that all members of the Eurosystem may use. Now, what is the modus operandi for the performance of this task? Well, basically, it follows one key principle, centralized decision making and operational decentralization. What is in the statute, that Article 8, is that the decision-making bodies govern the Eurosystem. These bodies take all the necessary decisions to enable the Eurosystem members to carry out their tasks. So this is centralized decision. It's not only limited to the formulation of policies, change in interest rates and key interest rates, but it extends to the how is done the implementation of policies for the ECB and the ECBs. What the statute doesn't say is to what extent policies are to be implemented by the ECB or the ECBs. So we had to decide in practice. And what has been decided is that for the bulk of the Eurosystem activities, the division of labor would be guided by the principle of decentralization. What is in the statute is Article 12.1. The ECB shall have recourse to the NCBs to the extent deemed possible and appropriate to carry out operations, etc. By the way, this principle of decentralization should not be confused, as it is sometimes, with the principle of subsidiarity in the EU. So what subsidiarity means is that the need for centralization must be proven conclusively before it is decided to take action at the EU level. Here we are dealing with activities where, at the political level, the decision has been made, as monetary policy and related tasks. We are in an area in which action has to be taken exclusively at the EU area level, period. And so there is no question whether the action is to be performed at the level of the system or left in the hands of national authorities. That's not the issue. It is to assess which part of the federal system is going to operationally do the work, perform the task. As the statute would say, to evaluate the extent at which, to which decentralization is possible. So now, what is the operational setup? Well, in line with this principle of decentralization, in practice, the NCBs perform almost all operational tasks of the Eurosystem, at least the bulk of them. In particular, they conduct the monetary policy operations. The banks have their accounts with the NCBs. The NCBs refinance the banks. The NCBs buy normally the securities, but there are interventions like international monetary policy. Even if the ECB itself does a little bit of it, but the bulk is done by the NCBs. Even for a number of things, they are agents of the ECB. For instance, for external operations, it is the ECB that is deemed to intervene. But in practice, when there are foreign exchange interventions in the market, it's mostly the NCBs that intervene. They manage the foreign exchange reserves transferred to the ECB. Each of the NCBs has a part corresponding more or less to what it has transferred. I don't know, there are some specializations among the NCBs. The NCBs provide permanent settlement, security settlement facilities. They ensure, they deal with banknotes. Procurement issue, post-issue handling of your banknotes. They collect statistics. They contribute to economic analysis. They bring in the models and the studies conducted by the ECB, all the information, the analysis they can do at home. A lot of research is done and we have set up, of course, organized with networks to do all this. So it's interesting to note that the common language is miles away from the reality I described. When people say, for instance, the ECB is injecting liquidity, or that the ECB is buying securities, they refer, in fact, to actions performed by the ECBs. Those actions appear on the balance sheet of those NCBs. The financial outcome, the profit of and loss, is mostly also written by NCBs. We have decided at the beginning that we would hand over 8% to the ECB, but that's to allow it to work, but that's all. And when I list, and by the way, this income is shared, but it's in the profit and loss accounts of the national central banks. And when the analysts talk of the balance sheet of the ECB, in fact, what they refer to is the consolidated Eurosystem balance sheet, not the balance sheet of the ECB, which is this high degree of decentralization is also mirrored in the distribution of staff. If you take out the banking supervision function, which doesn't exist everywhere or exists now in most places, speaking of Eurosystem functions, the ECB staff accounts today, all in all, to around 1,700 staff members. We have more or less, without supervision, 40,000 in the system today, slowly decreasing. If we take into account the supervisory function, at both levels, the respective numbers today would be close to 3,000 and 48,000. So in the first case, I come to a percentage of 4.5%. Second look, I come to around 6%. Knowing that in national central banks, in at least some or most national central banks, there are at different degrees national tasks which are not your system related. I'll come back to that in a minute. So I would say probably we are around 5%, probably in terms of your system tasks, somewhat above 5%, but that's the order of magnitude. When you look at the Federal Reserve, the proportion between the staff and the rule of governance in Washington, the staff, the addition of staff in the 12 Federal Reserve banks, you come to 5%. So we are really in something that is of the same order of magnitude, and that's it's interesting to me, because I think it's totally logical in what I consider to be a really federal system. Of course, the fact that the Governing Council is the main decision-making body is entitled to take the most important strategically significant decisions for the ecosystem is a strong element pushing for maintaining a decentralized network. Of course, the Governing Council itself is a centralized body, but its composition with all ECB governors and the six members of the executive board, all the governments are attentive to keeping the balance that was set in the statute. And there is a clear difference in my view with the Fed. In the case of the Fed, the same composition as the Governing Council exists for the FOMC. The FOMC is really dealing with monetary policy. But the organization of the system is in the hands of the Board of Governors, which is the equivalent of our executive board. So in their case, well, they have respected the decentralization because they are thinking federal. In the case of the Eurosystem, it's probably the fact that the Governing Council has both responsibilities, that is helping to keep the, or to wait against the tendency to centralize the Governing Council has established 12 committees to assist the work of decision-making bodies. They provide expertise in the field of competence. They facilitate the decision-making process, preparing technically possible decisions, and they facilitate the implementation process. And that has been very successful. I think it is contributing to the smooth functioning of the system because it's not only the central bank governors who are involved in the cooperative action, but everybody in this field of competence, and that covers many things, of course, monetary policy, market operations, payment systems, statistics, banknotes, but also support areas like accounting, internal audit, legal issues, information technology. And that is a strong support to the well-functioning of the system. One word on an interesting concept, in my view, which is the concept of concentration. What I mean is, over time, the tendency of the system to streamline its organization, to improve efficiency and effectiveness, tends to lead to progressive concentration of activities and technical systems. And that has been observed everywhere, even in the case of the federal system. But concentrate does not mean necessarily centralization. The concentration can be obtained by delegating part of the work to a few national central banks and making the system work in the way that it is operated by all members of the Eurosystem to perform a certain task. The best example, and most famous, by the way, is Balladur. When we started the IIEA, the prime we had was to unify the main market. So how to do it when you need to link the RTGS system, to have a unified money market, gross payments going. So we linked that. But we all had different systems, different technologies. And we know that the camp system is very is fragile. It's not very well performing and it's costly. So when we had to prepare the second generation, we thought we're not going to create again 11 or 12 or 15 or 19 payment systems with different technologies and create new links, and that would be crazy. It's very costly, very inefficient, and very dangerous. So, but does it mean that we have to create the system to ask the ECB to create and run the system and concentrate all the links of the banks there? No. What we did was the Governing Council selected a group of ECBs ready to make a joint venture to offer the system, to create the system, and to concentrate, of course, the computers in several places to have the government, not one single place. And then to have, so it would be only one system, but there would be terminals of this network in all NCBs, so the connection with the commercial banks would remain exactly the same. So seen from the customer banks, it's always it is the NCB. Like in Target 1, in practice the system is operated with different computers in Frankfurt, in Rome, and in Paris, and that's it. And the ECB is doing the surveillance of the well functioning of the system. So that is the idea that we have developed at that time. The same idea has been taken over 42S. There are a number of less known examples that are either existing or under preparation for the future. A last word on national tasks. I don't want to be too long because we should be able to try to be short. Apart from the Eurosystem task, the national central banks can be defined to have national tasks, set by the treaty. And the only condition is that they do not infringe upon the they do not interfere with the objectives and tasks of the Eurosystem. Those national tasks vary from one country to another. It's mostly administrative and financial services to the government, and that includes almost everywhere a typical function that of fiscal agent of the government. Now, there are two cases, probably famous in Ireland, where the frontier between Eurosystem and non-Eurosystem related tasks was not so obvious. One was the famous ELA, the Emergency Liquidity Assistance. Although that consists of providing liquidity, they are relative to the function of lending of last resort vis-à-vis the banking system of each individual country. The objective, therefore, is not the management of liquidity in the system as a whole, which is a tool of monetary policy, but it is the injection of liquidity selectively to one or several banks facing the liquidity shortage. Now, when we discussed that at the beginning, the Governing Council decided that this is a national task. But of course, there is a possible interference with monetary policy because that's allows to create liquidity. So it must be under surveillance. So we set the rules, a surveillance framework, which leads to the Governing Council assessing the regularity, right, assessing the projected operations regularly, and eventually objecting or not to their realization. And that enables also the Governing Council to take into account the amount of liquidity that goes that way to eventually compensate for the natural forces. So it must not be too big so that it does not prevent the good management of liquidity. Of course, with the banking union, the question came back whether it should or not be considered as a Eurosystem task. So far, the Governing Council has said no, it will remain a national task. Also, because we don't want to create a link that the governments and parliament have asked us not to create between monetary policy and supervision. So, since we have to keep a sort of Chinese wall inside the ECB, it's not to recreate their, but of course, intellectually, at least for the so-called banks and the direct supervision, one could maybe that is something that will come back in the future. Another sensitive issue is the building of portfolios of securities by ECBs, what we call the unfound portfolio, the asset on the agreement. The origin is very simple. At the beginning of the EMU, some SMBs had small portfolios of securities, or small or not small, portfolios of securities. Some SMBs even had a few loans to government, sometimes big loans to governments that were coming from the past. They had not considered the convergence period, but sometimes they had old loans that were long-term loans. So we had to decide what to do with all that. And since we had the possibility, we thought what the best is to probably give each NCB the capacity to buy, hold, and manage a small portfolio. And of course, we will decide every year in the Governing Council the ceilings. We will set rules so that you cannot support the government with that. You can only invest small amounts in certain periods of time. You are invited to make a diversification in your portfolio, not have a single signature in your portfolio, but it's possible. And the ECB also mandates compliance with the non-monetary financing requirements that are Article 101-102 of the treaty. So that's where we are, and of course there have been de facto some links, let's say, between the two concepts, the alien and far, but you know that very well. A last word on banking supervision, but I will be very short because I'm too long in my presentation. Let's say, at the beginning of MU, a number of NCBs were involved in banking supervision. It was typically a national task. Most of them, with partly the exception of the Bundesbank, although banking supervision responsibility is in the BaFin, but the Bundesbank has the bulk of staff working on banking supervision. So it's a complex situation in Germany. At the time, there were Belgium, Finland, and Luxembourg, I think, with no banking supervision responsibility. Sort of FSA type was a minority. After the crisis, Belgium has moved from one camp to the other, and now it's the NCB in charge. So it's really, and the new NCBs, most of them have the banking supervision responsibility. It's in Cyprus, it's true in Slovakia, in Slovenia, so it's really, really the model. Now, with the creation of the banking union, one could have thought, well, it could have been simple to establish more or less the same kind of sovereignty. For reasons which were essentially that it had been decided not to revise the treaty, And although the treaty itself was referring to the Eurosystem in assigning the task to contribute to the smooth conduct of policies relating to banking supervision, what has been used legally is an article of the statutes enabling the Council of Ministers to confer to the ECB specific missions in the domain of prudential supervision. In that case, a specific mission is very big. And there was a tendency of the ECB during the negotiation to also ask for a lot of centralization. So we have a system that is slightly different, with legally a lot of responsibilities given to the ECB, it's called the so-called banks under direct supervision. The ECB and not the system as a whole. In fact, that not 100% of the countries have the ECB as the supervisor was a problem. In practice, most of the workforce is still at the national level, but it's working less as a federal system than it's maybe in the case of traditional transnational policy. So I conclude here. I believe the system is coherent thanks to the unicity of rules and centralized decision making. It is highly decentralized, and that means that it is, in my view, more efficient than if it were centralized. By the way, the cost of a staff member at the ECB is somewhat 50% above the cost of a staff member, cost of a staff member at the ECB level. So if we were to transfer, say, 20,000 or 30,000 people to Frankfurt, that would be a huge cost. For, in my view, much less efficiency. Also, the cost of dealing with several legal systems, several languages, is much lower if it is on the level, the decentralized level, but if it were done centrally. And finally, I believe that it's an important feature for the political acceptance of having delegated what is at law an important part of sovereignty